We're continuing our study of Ten Commandments, and today we have the eighth. I want to invite you to read this passage, Exodus chapter 20. You already have a bookmark there, so let's read verse 15. Exodus 20, verse 15. You shall not steal. You shall not steal. The eighth commandment. I don't know about you, but I did catch myself throughout my life in the situation where I realized I'm a thief. I've stolen something. Let me illustrate this. I don't know, maybe some of you actually have been in this situation where you do some grocery shopping. You come to your car, you open the trunk and start unloading things out of your cart. And then you stop. You realize on the bottom, on the very bottom of your cart, the things that you didn't put on the counter, they were not scanned by the cashier. And I don't know if you've been in that situation, but your whole world falls apart. And I did it in the daylight in front of the people. I'm a thief. I just stole all those. Usually it's a big chunk of, you know, toilet paper or something, you know, and you're like, I've done that. It's not a little piece of gum. It's just a huge box of stuff. And so you feel so guilty. You feel so ashamed. You feel like you're a thief. And everyone on the parking lot is staring at you. You took that paper down. And so you turn around and you go back and you approach that cashier and say, hey, I'm so sorry. I'm a thief. I repent. And you stand there on your knees and you don't do that. You pay for that, right? There's a good thing is you can restore yourself, your conscience right there immediately and you, okay. Now I can use this paper. And so you go home. But many of the kids probably can relate in a different way when parents helped you realizing that you're a thief. Maybe you've taken a candy. We're in the middle of that at home, by the way. A side note. And you took that chocolate, you ate that chocolate, and then what do you do with that wrapper? You hide it. You hide it under the couch. But it gets discovered. But those parents, they see everything, they're sneaky. And then you're called out, and the evidence is there. The chocolate is right around. And the wrapper is right there. And the smell, breathe. Oh yeah, it smells like chocolate. And you are cut. Maybe some of you remember that. Maybe some of you were in the process of that today. Experienced that today. Many of us had the sin of stealing exposed through our lives. But some might not have experience like that. Maybe you haven't. And today's topic is going to be a huge blessing. And I want to start with some interesting statistics. Reading of it was interesting for me to discover that in U.S. today, property theft occurs in some form every 3 seconds. Every 3 seconds. Property theft. Washington state property crime rate is the sixth highest in all the states. So we're somewhere up front. About 4 million people are caught shoplifting each year. But statistics say that about 35 go undetected. So only 4 million got caught. The rest are just find their way out. 30% of all business failures each year are a direct result of internal theft. In other words, 30% of businesses just fall apart just because people are stealing inside. 9% of all employees steal on a regular basis. Theft from hotels is a classic one, right? Hotel managers count on one of every three guests stealing something. I mean, it starts from dryers, irons, towels, and all kinds of towels and all kinds of other things. And some people even do TVs, and you just want to take something. I like this room so much, I want to have a good memory of it. I'm going to take this queen bed, you know. Book thieves take from 200 to 500 books a year from an average library. The national loss, $25 million each year, just for not returning books to your libraries. Many of you, of course, say, well, I don't fall in any of these categories. We're going to talk about different ways we do steal. And you, thinking of it, I uncovered so many ways I'm cutting corners myself. But some interesting biblical statistics. Do you know what was the first sin in the Bible? God said to Adam, don't take from this tree. Eve, Adam looking around, God is not around. We're taking what's not ours. The very first sin in the Bible is the sin of stealing. The very first sin Israel did in the promised land, when God redeemed them, took them out of Egypt, brought them in the promised land, the very first sin recorded, and probably were more, but recorded. Who remembers? What was the very first sin recorded in the Bible done by Israel in the promised land? Achan. Stealing what was dedicated to God. He liked the clothes. He liked the gold. I'm going to steal it from God. Very first sin. Fast forward a few thousand years. New Testament church. Book of Acts. The church just started. Pentecost. Just a few days later, the very first sin recorded in the Bible. Ananias and Sapphira bring some money, but some we're going to give it. We're going to steal from God. We want to show it as if everything is given to God, but we're going to be still pulling some our way. It's interesting. There's so much theft in the Bible. Jesus was crucified on the cross prepared for whom? For Barabbas. Who was Barabbas? A thief, a robber. He was crucified in the place of a thief. And guess who were hanging with him, next to him? Two guys. Thieves. He died among thieves in the place of a thief. So think of Jacob with his mother stealing his blessing from his brother. Joseph's brothers stealing his freedom, selling Joseph. David taking what's not his. The classic one is Jezebel and Ahab. Remember that? The vineyard? Taking what's not yours. Judas. Pharisees. And the list can go on and on. This book is full of thieves. Full of thieves. The world we're living is full of thieves. It's interesting. As I was reading this, I decided to just ask three questions from this text. Verse 15, you shall not steal. I want to ask three questions for our edification. Looking at this passage, looking at this command, I want us to walk away more like Christ. And here's how we're going to do it. Three simple questions. The very first question is, who is a thief? Who is a thief? Let's deal with this. So what is stealing? Stealing is taking something that does not belong to you without a permission. Something does not belong to you. It's not yours. And you have not asked for this. Stealing, taking what's not yours. Mainly, usually people think of money. But let me just, I have 8 different categories of stealing. So first one is resources. Something just classical, something that's not yours. Not your car, not your dollar, not your washing machine, whatever people steal on it. Resources. Second category, time. We steal people's time. How? At work, arriving late to meetings. Some of you have stolen our time by coming late today, just a side note. So, very applicable, by the way. Leaving early, some of you will rob us of your time by leaving. No, just kidding. At work, we're coming late, we're leaving early, we're stretching our breaks, we're surfing the web while on the clock, working half effort, we're stealing time from people. Third, information. Do you know that information can be stolen? This is why we have all those passwords, and we forget them. We have to reinstall all stuff, kind of stuff. But why? Why? Because there's identity theft. There's all kinds of information can be stolen. Copyrights. This is why we have copyrights. This is why copy-pasting and then you call it research doesn't work. We cheat. We copy someone else's work. That's information theft. Fourth, the unpaid debts. We take loan, we borrow money, and then we find ways not to return this. It's stealing from the borrower. Fifth category, someone's reputation. The ruined reputation. We steal someone's opportunities. How? By spreading gossip, by ruining their reputation by gossip. And that's stealing their opportunities because they no longer have a good standing. Shakespeare wrote, "Who steals my purse steals trash. But he that filches from my good name makes me poor indeed." In other words, the one who steals my purse is trash. But who steals my name makes me poor. I no longer can apply. I no longer get respect. Sixth way we steal is carelessness and indifference toward the need of others. And that's stealing. If you haven't closed Exodus, just turn one page to chapter 23. A good example of it. Verse 4 and 5. "If you meet your enemy's ox and his donkey going astray," it doesn't say you shall not steal it. It says you shall bring it back to him. "If you see the donkey of one who hates you," it's not the best context, your neighbor hates you, and you see his donkey laying down under the burden, its burden, "you shall refrain from leaving him." You should refrain. There will be temptation. "I didn't see that. I have so many things to do. I'm ignoring this." He says, "No, from leaving, don't leave him with it. You shall rescue it with him." You should go and help. Turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 22. Similar situation, a little more context. I hope you will see this could be an eye opener for some of you that, look, I'm never taking even a little piece of gum. But this is a theft. Deuteronomy 22. "You shall not see your brother's ox or his sheep going astray and ignore them." You should not ignore. "You shall take them back to your brother. And if he does not live near you and you do not know who he is, you shall bring it home in your house and it shall stay with you until your brother seeks it. Then you shall restore it to him. And you shall do the same with the donkey or with his garment." You walk on the street and there is on the sides a nice jacket. Whose jacket? Nobody's. It's my jacket. "Or with any lost thing of your brother's." Any lost thing of your brother's. "Which he loses and you find, You may not ignore it. You shall not see your brother's donkey or his ox fallen down by the way and ignore them. You shall help him to lift them up again. It's an interesting way of stealing by not helping the person in need. Number 7, gambling. Gambler is a refined thief because his way of thinking, his motive is the same as of a thief. Something for nothing. That's a gambling. Something for nothing. 8, the last one and the most terrible one is stealing from God. There's a passage in the Bible, Malachi. I want all of us to go to Malachi. Leave a mark in Exodus 20, but let's race to Malachi chapter 3. I'll race you. Malachi 3. I don't hear pages. Am I by myself with the Bible? Let's do it together. It's better if we hear one another flipping pages. So, okay, now you force us to pull our Bibles, huge Bibles. But this is good. This is good. You need to remember this. If you will have a conversation with someone about giving to God, this is a good passage to go to. Malachi chapter 3, verse 7. From the days of your fathers, you have turned aside from my statutes and have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. But you say, how shall we return? Will man rob God? Yet you are robbing me. But you say, how have we robbed you? In your tithes and contributions. You are cursed with a curse, for you are robbing me, the whole nation of you. Bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and thereby put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing until there's no more need. I will rebuke the devourer for you, so that it will not destroy the fruits of your soil and your vine, and the field that field shall not fail to bear, says the Lord of hosts. Then all nations will call you blessed, for you will be a land of delight, says the Lord of hosts. So it's interesting that actually people of Israel at that time were stealing from God. God says, if you don't bring money to me in my house, you are robbing me. Now, parents might not see you sneaking some candies and taking some candies. Neighbors might not see that you are eating their apples from their tree that just hangs over your side. Whatever. That's a good example, by the way, right? What do you do with the apples that hanging over your yard? It's my yard. No, it's wrong. It's not your tree. You can go and ask. But with God, stealing from God, this is the last book of the Old Testament, and God is still teaching Israel, guys, you are thieves. You're a bunch of thieves. Why is this important? Because all of those 8 categories reveal something about our hearts. Mainly, simple thing. We love money. I wanted to bring, yeah, I did bring. Okay, $5. Why do we love money? Is this the most prettiest thing in the world? If I were to hang a nice painting here and this, what would you choose? You would still choose this. Well, no, actually, it's valuable, right? But maybe a nice postcard, okay? Nice postcard. More beautiful, right? Than this. And still you would take $5. Because postcard is what? Like $1 or $1.50, right? Why? So it's not because the looks. It's not because of the smells, definitely. Definitely not because of the smells. And not because of the taste. No, I'm not going to. Not because of the taste, not because of the looks, but because the purchasing power of the money, right? Because what I can buy, what this paper promises, some kind of possession that it's promised. In itself, it's just a paper, right? Why do we love money? It's not because of this greenish color that just fascinates us. No, it's what it can provide, the promise of the money. We can purchase something on this. And so a thief goes after that property, that possession, without earning this money and then paying for it. This is too much. Why just take a shortcut and claim it mine? That's what it means. We don't want to earn so that then we pay for it. We just take a circle and just grab the possession of the property or whatever that is, time, reputation, and all other things. Why? Because of the love of mammoth. It comes, this roots, if we try to describe this roots, why people steal, it comes out of discontent, definitely. I'm not happy with what I have. I want more, I want different, I want new. It comes out of blind competitiveness, envy, jealousy. I don't have it, I want it. Simple greed. And in the New Testament, Paul says the root of all evil is what? Concludes everything. Love of money. Love of things. And that's the root of all evil. So it drives, it feeds all other evils. Why is it important to talk about this? I want to read one passage that hopefully will awaken some of you at this moment in sermon. Ephesians chapter 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 10. 1 Corinthians 6, 10. Well, actually, let's read verse 9, so we'll read in the context. Or do you not know that unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. And then he gives the list of people that will not inherit the kingdom of God. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality. Verse 10, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. So why this passage, why this talk is so important? Because it's not something like, oh, I'm sorry, I just like to take things that are not mine. No, it has to do with your eternal destiny. If you are a thief and you don't know this, you must know it today. Because you will not enter the kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God, if you don't address this issue. So the next question automatically comes, and this is our next question. How not to be a thief? Okay, so we identify a thief. We identify the way we steal. We identify the root of it. It's the love of things. It's discontent. We understand where it all grows. But how not to be a thief? How to get rid of this inclination of my heart? How to stop being a thief? My question to you, when a thief stops being a thief? Kids, when a thief that steals candies stops being a thief. When? At the moment that he's no longer taking a candy. I'm not taking candies right now. Am I a thief or not? Can you tell me? So when a thief stops being a thief, when a liar stops being a liar, When I'm no longer stealing? No. because as soon as someone is, nobody is watching, I can be back in business. So when we stop being thieves, how can we measure that process of no longer being a thief? Good question. Ephesians gives us a very, very clear answer. Turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4, the passage Andrew read with us, and now you read with the question, how a thief is no longer a thief? What's the process? How do I know if my kid or myself is no longer a thief? Ephesians 4, verse 28. Let the thief no longer steal. That's what everyone thinks. But there's a comma. And the New Testament explains in depth when a thief is no longer a thief, but rather let him labor doing honest work with his own hands. And a lot of people want to stop here, but the New Testament adds another comma and says, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Oh, it's interesting. So first thing first, of course, you stop being a thief when you stop stealing. That's a very first step. Very first step. And so young and old, if you are taking something, either time at work or someone's reputation by ruining it with the gossip, whatever that is, how do you stop stealing? First, being a thief, first you stop doing that. Second, let him labor. The word labor is hard work. It's not just, hey, try to get some job. No. It says, you need to work hard. It's kind of like chopping the wood for me. I'm not usually in the physical labor. So when I need to chop the wood for our winter, if I work half a day, I'm dead. Literally dead, kind of work. That's the labor he's describing here. After which you are coming home and say, please, honey, put me together. I am done. I worked hard. We had a really tough project. That's exactly the word used here. So it's not just, hey, get yourself a job. It says you need to learn to sweat. Now, this doesn't mean that you need to now come out of it and say, which is the most sweatiest job in Vancouver? I'm going to look for a sweatiest job, and I'm going to come next Sunday and not take shower and just prove everyone I labor. Please don't do that. It means you are no longer lazy, because a thief is the guy who doesn't work, doesn't want to work. He's a lazy. And so Ephesians says, well, a thief starts healing from his disease of theft. First, by stop doing this. Second, he enters a workforce. He works. Make your kids work. Don't wait until they're 18. They can wash their dishes. They can put their beds together. They can do a lot of things. Same thing adults. Same thing teenagers. All kinds of people can work. Not can, they must work. God, in His providence, designed people for work. When He created Adam, very first thing He did to him, what? Adam. Here's the garden. Work it and keep it. That's the essence of being like God. God creates things from day one. He works, He produces. And then He creates Adam and says, you keep the same thing. You work, meaning produce, and then you keep it. You sustain it. There's two types of jobs. We produce and then we distribute. But that's not all. We don't stop here. First, we stop stealing. Then we got ourselves busy with productive work. What for? He gives a vision so that we may have something to share. That's a scary word, share. If you have kids and you say share, they fight. You say to adults, share. Try it. McDonald's next time you come. See that? someone is eating, you come sit next to it. Share. See what happens. We don't like to share. I've earned. I sweat it. I work hard for this $5. And you come and you say, share. Well, the Bible turns around and says, we, those who work hard, if we don't want to be thieves. We don't steal. We work hard so that we give. A lot of people get lost either on the first one. Well, I'm a good Christian. I don't steal. You're a thief. Those, read again those eight ways we steal. You steal from others. When do you stop being a thief? When you start working so that you provide for yourself, and more than that, you can actually care for others. Some people stop there and say, great, I'm gonna just keep working and I'm gonna just keep this. You're still a thief. So you're robbing God and others of a blessing that God has given you. So a thief, really no longer a thief, is goes all the way and says, you know what? All this I have is given by God to give back to God and to care for the needy. That's what it is. The word share is here. Give to others. Kent Hughes writes, interesting, very, very interesting. Every time I give, meaning financially, every time I give, I declare that money does not control me. Perpetual generosity is perpetual deification of money. Perpetual generosity or giving, sharing, is a perpetual deification of money. You catch that? Someone else said, money is a bad master, but a good servant. How do you turn things around? Is by giving. And so this is why the middle part is so important, that we work hard, we produce more. You guys start businesses, invest, save, twist things so that it works and produces the most. Definitely. So this passage does not teach that we just need to be, we're not stealing, we're going to just be poor and that. No. You don't steal. That's for, then you work hard and produce maximum. What for? For the third stage, you learn to bless others, to care for others. That's a point when you are set free, no longer a thief. Do you catch that? We get lost somewhere in the middle. We're half thieves. We haven't done all the way. We haven't gone all the way to get rid of this image of a thief. We from childhood, think of my stuff. Why is it important? Because the gospel itself, at its core, preaches this. You know what the gospel is? God, being a creator, created the universe. But what we just sang, He purchased our salvation. He bought our redemption. God didn't just say, let there be salvation, and salvation appeared. He could have created by word, salvation comes. No, He comes and dies on the cross, purchases, pays. You see, the essence of the gospel is not, it's free for us, it's a gift, we don't work for it. But Jesus sweated for this, blood. He worked hard on the cross. And before cross, He lived a perfect, righteous life so that it can be imputed to us. Was it easy? No, it wasn't. He worked hard for 30 plus years so that that righteousness is freely given to us. Do you catch that? The essence of the gospel demands, absolutely denies thievery. Because Jesus worked hard to give. Ephesians 4:28 is exemplified in the gospel like no other places. It's free to us, but He worked hard. Last question. why the gospel is only for thieves. Why the gospel is only for thieves. We sang Jesus is a friend, or we've heard a group sing, Jesus is a friend of sinners. I wanted to stand in the middle of the song and say, Jesus is a friend of thieves, and sit down. But that would not help the musicians. I want to do it now. Jesus is a friend of thieves. Maybe we can twist one verse there in that song. Next time sing, Jesus is a friend of thieves. And see, I cannot change that. It's stuck. I want to use this passage in Exodus 20, verse 15, you shall not steal, and apply it in the way that we haven't applied yet. And yet it's one of the purposes of the Ten Commandments is to reveal to us our true state. We talked about God. As we see God through the Ten Commandments, we saw that each commandment leads us to Christ, and it's a good instruction for life, absolutely. But also, it reveals our sinfulness. Let me ask you, especially kids, children, have you ever stolen anything? Even a little piece of gum? Have you ever taken something that's not yours? Have you ever stolen something, kids? Just honest. Adults. Okay, if we have done that, I've done it, I can confess. So if a preacher confesses, then you can as well. It's fine. It's okay. But what does it make us? If we steal something, it makes us what? It's scary to say, but it makes us into thieves. How many times should I steal, or do I have to steal to become a thief? How many times? Just one. So we all have done that. And so, sorry, kind of it's uncomfortable to say, but a bunch of thieves. Welcome. Now, if God were to judge us and he were to pull out 10 commandments and say, okay, I wrote in Exodus chapter 20. You know Exodus 20? Yeah, we know. Have you read verse 15? Yes, we read it. Let me read it again to you. You shall not steal. That's my command. It's my command. I commanded it thousands of years ago. Have you stolen anything? Yes. I'm a thief. What God must do at that moment? He must judge. So in other words, one of the reasons why this passage is here is to help us understand that we're guilty. Understand that we have broken that. That command, you shall not, we have broken. And so we should stand condemned and guilty before God. And some of you should at this moment, as we describe this, you're like, yes, I am a thief. I have broken that. And if God were to judge me right after he shows up in the parking lot after this service and pulls me over and says, here's 10 commandments, let's have a check, evaluation. I will be guilty. I need to do something. Some of you probably now should be asking this question, what should I do? It's a good question. And some of you are thinking, oh, Christ, I know Christ, and he died for my sins. Yes. But I want first to talk to those who have never dealt with their guilt. What do? Do you start convincing yourself that I'm not going to do this anymore? It's interesting that we learned of a story of a condemned thief in Luke 23. Turn with me to Luke 23. A thief in God's providence God brought this thief. He was stealing all his life. If God wants to save this thief, you know what he does? He designed in his providence, I'm going to nail this guy next to a cross of Jesus. And I'm going to have him a first-hand experience with the Savior. And I'm going to wait until the very last minute of his life. And I'm going to snatch him for eternity. I'm going to save him for eternity. Read this. This is such an amazing story. This is great hope for all us thieves. Verse 19. Chapter 23. Luke 23. Did I say 19? Say 39 probably, right? Yes, 39. One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, at Jesus, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God?" Where did that fear come from? God had to bring him all the way to the cross. Since you are under the same sentence of condemnation. He is condemned. He feels he is a thief. He knows that. And then he continues, "And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He said to him, "Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Just think about it. God saved this guy in a way it's just unthinkable. He designed this guy to be cut and assigned to be crucified, and God orchestrated that he would be next to Jesus before he dies, have a conversation, and then he says, "Forgive me, remember me," and then he died later than Jesus, right? And so he received this forgiveness, and then he watched firsthand his redemption being purchased. Firsthand, first row experience. Just think about it. Jesus died for his sins right there. And he's watching. My forgiveness. Right there. But. Amazing. Amazing. Any thief. If this thief gets saved right before death, any thief, if anyone today is condemned and guilty because of sin that you've done, God is giving you first row experience to see your forgiveness done right before your eyes. Better than this, nothing. Nothing is better than this. All these possessions, forget that. Now, for those of you who are believers and you say, "Well, Jesus, I saw Jesus died. I know he died for my sins. What this commandment, you shall not steal," I want to challenge you. Not long ago, someone asked me, give us a visual or example what it means to live by Christ. We all use this. Christ in me, I live for Christ, no longer for myself, but for Christ. What it means, live by Christ? Here's my short answer. If you were to take Christ out of your life, and nothing changes. You catch that? If someone were to take Christ out of your life and nothing changes in the ways you live, everything will be the same. You're not living by Christ. Just think about it. If Christ were to take ripped out of your life today, in your life will continue the same. You're going to go to the same school, do the same work, the same family, and do everything, and nothing changed. You're not living by Christ. But if things that we're teaching today and looking into bring Christ, then at least two things that I can think of from our study today that should set you separate away from everyone else, if Christ is part of your life. First, you really work hard. You know, we're living in a generation where that's not true. If manager is not watching you, things go down. Is that... this is not right. Because God is watching. Because Jesus is watching. Are you stealing in front of Jesus? If Jesus is part of my life, I work hard when nobody's watching. I work hard. I'm not a thief. And not because I just want to be moving up in my career, because I'm going to want to be a manager. So I want to... no, no, no. Jesus is watching me. That's very important. Second, I give. And it only makes sense if Jesus is real, if he's watching and applauding every time I give. I say, I'm going to give. I'm going to bless this man. I'm going to help this family. I'm going to invest in the kingdom. I'm going to give to church, and I'll give you extra. If Jesus is taking it, like, why would you do that? I want to pray with all of us, confessing that probably there is some room to grow for us believers. And we will pray with and for those who might realize, maybe realized their true standing before Christ as a guilty thief. And maybe God brought you specifically to that point in life where you can't do anything. You're already nailed. You're already nailed by life. There's no way out. And you're just like, I don't see how I can get out of this situation. And say, that's the situation exactly the same that the thief on the cross was. He couldn't get out. This is it. This is the end of the road. And God rescued him. What a promise. What a joy. Shall we stand and pray? Join me. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this simple phrase that Jesus is a friend of sinners. As we deal with a sin of theft, when we steal from others, from you, we find promise and comfort that you can forgive, but you only forgive to those who confess, who before you are broken. But then, like Zacchaeus, we leap with joy. We run with joy. We jump and ready to give. And the possessions are no longer valuable because our guilt is taken away. Our conscience is clear. We know Christ is our Savior and Lord. Father, make us into a people that are driven by Christ, that their lives are marked by Christ's presence at work, at school, in our neighborhoods, in our families. May we be hard workers, not because we just make more, but because Christ is glorified through that, and then we give, and we give more, and we give more. Because we're not bound by this, because we are yours. Thank you so much for Christ, who worked hard for our salvation. Amen.